Hello everyone, welcome to another night of NizCast. We're of course casting the Semi-Pro Cup Series as we do every Sunday. Starting off in the quarterfinals as, well, we also do every Sunday. Dark but I'm Niz, guys, and hopefully you're ready for some great Dota. Hopefully you're high off watching the majors, the Frankfurt majors. There were some incredible games, and if those majors are anything kind of foreshadowing what's to come with Dota, we've got some exciting Dota coming. But yeah, I'm gonna try not to spoil in case someone hasn't seen it. I know it's a lot of games and people need some time to catch up and watch some of the games, but if you're gonna watch any series, winners bracket finals. Those were some great series, and then of course the grand finals were pretty damn good as well. But this isn't the majors. This is the semi-pro cup series. So let's catch up and find out where we are in the draft. First of all, we'll introduce the teams. On the Dire side, we're going to have Knights, which we've seen here before. I believe last week we cast them in the quarterfinals as well. They lost out to, it was World's End, which eventually went on to the finals, which played against our team on the Radiant side, FNMDX, which is actually are back-to-back champions right now. They've won the last 2 weeks of SCS, and they're going to look to make it a third. I also believe World's End is still alive in the brackets as well, so we could very well see a rematch. We've got I think it's the Mighty Lobster Fisherman is the team waiting for this game to finish in the semifinals. But let's catch up in the draft. We've got Tusk and Doom banned out by Knights, Undying and Winter Wyvern banned out by FNMDX. Then we saw the first pick, Shadow Fiend, followed up by the Darkseer and Dazzle, then the Earthshaker to close out our first round of picks and bans. Then we had the Huskar ban, so no Huskar shenanigans. AA was banned, Gyro's banned, and now Slardar is banned. And now we're all caught up. Actually, no, we're not. We fell behind because they just picked Ember Spirit, but now we're caught up. So what do we got so far? We got a Darkseer offlane. Ember Spirit could be mid going up against that Shadow Fiend, but they could just slide that into the safe lane if they don't want that matchup. But it's not the worst matchup in the world. When Ember first got added to competitive? Or was it just when SF came back into the meta? I can't remember if those lined up. But there's much
5 seconds remaining.
I don't want to say controversy, discussion about whether or not Ember wins that lane, Shadow Fiend wins that lane, which way it's favored. But it's kind of shaken down a little bit more now. And we've got a Radiant Shadow Fiend, so he can just go into the jungle anyways. It's pretty much impossible to stop a Shadow Fiend from farming. And one of the heroes that's great against Shadow Fiend is, well, it's going to be on the team of the Shadow Fiend. That's the Clockwork. So we're going to have a Radiant side Clockwork. It means our Earthshaker is going to be probably that roaming four position. Now we got a Queen of Pain pickup, Radiant, which could be mid against the Shadow Fiend instead, an Ember safe lane, which is probably what we'll see with the Darkseer off lane. Dazzle supporting the Ember, and then we'll be waiting on one more support pick from Knights, which probably will be someone who's going to roam around or kind of stick up in the top lane a little bit more. But we could very well see it something that kind of goes down and pairs with the Darkseer. We'll see. Darkseer typically doesn't have the greatest time against an Earthshaker, but it's Darkseer. I mean, it's you put Ion Shells and you can control the creep wave, making it almost impossible for the enemy hard carry to really control the creep equilibrium and stop you from getting CS, but also XP. So now we're waiting on FNMDX, probably going to be their support hero here. They could choose to pick up a carry. Oh, we're going to go a Disruptor, okay. Disruptor is actually great against Knight's lineup. The Static Storm is good against stopping Queen of Pain from not only being able to blink out, but stopping her from doing anything while she's trapped in there. And then, of course, it's great for stopping the Ember Spirit from jumping away. And then you could always glimpse him. That's a little bit more tricky. But you could always glimpse him back. Glimpse, worst grade against the Queen of Pain blank. It's great against Darkseer running away with Surge, as well as the Kinetic Field. I believe it's called the Big Playpen. I believe it's Kinetic Field. It is. Is great against Darkseer as well. So Disruptor, it's a pretty valuable hero for them here. The downside to Disruptor is if he falls behind early, he really, really struggles. More so than a lot of supports, but I don't really see any reason for him to fall behind in this lane. I don't think we're going to have tri-lane versus tri-lane, so he should be fine. And yeah, it just looks like an all-around great pick for them. So now we're just waiting for the last ban here. They're going to go Slark, so getting that out of the pool.
Radiant team ban.
Slark is pretty good against Darkseer. They could just go for the Animage, though. So Spirit Breaker is going to be the final ban from FNMDX. They're getting rid of that roaming potential, which would put a lot of pressure on the Shadow Fiend. Like I said, I expect it to be a hero that's going to be able to roam around. They don't really need another hero to stay at top 24/7 against that Clockwork. They've already got the Dazzle and the Ember. They should be able to zone the Clock relatively well. Dazzle's pretty good against Clock in terms of zoning him, but
5 seconds
not going to be able to kill him. And Dazzle certainly can't roam and put pressure on the Shadow Fiend. So we're going to look to see if they pick up something a little bit different different than the Dazzle to put some pressure on that SF. And not that they need help for the Queen of Pain, but to help out the Queen. I'm trying to think of what would be valuable. I'm actually thinking Bounty Hunter in my head here, but I don't know. I don't know if that's enough. It could be a pick. To hear that's going to put pressure on the Shadow Fiend. Night Stalker. Oh my goodness. I play this hero like every game. How did I not say Night Stalker? The Night Stalker roam is so scary for the SF. It's also a hero that pretty much dominates an Earthshaker. If he can get on him, the Earthshaker is pretty much screwed. You just void, slow down the Earthshaker, and if he can't TP out, then he's pretty much screwed. If he tries to stun, then you just silence him. And if you've got void still up, then he tries to stun and you void him again. So they both pick the Animage, so I was right about that. And yeah, that's going to be our lineup now. So they've got Animage going up against the Darkseer in the safe lane. Obviously, they're going to have supports down there, giving them a little bit of space. Once Darkseer falls behind in levels, as he should, getting zoned by the Disruptor, then Animage should be in a pretty good spot. If he can just blink on the Darkseer, burn some of his mana, it's going to be difficult for the Darkseer in the early stages until he gets his Soul Ring up. He'll have trouble just spamming Ion Shell, and that'll give the AM a little bit of space. But before we talk too much about the game, we'll introduce the team and the players as we do always. So on the Radiant side, well, they said that they might need a pause after the bans and picks. They said that before the fail to load last game. But we do have a little bit of a pause here. So I will actually, you know what, I will introduce. Normally I wait till the pause is over, but I'll introduce the teams because I always seem to run into the situation where the teams are clashing and I'm still trying to introduce. So, Radiant side, we're going to have our defending champions, our actual back-to-back defending champions, FNMDX, playing their Clockwork, is going to be their captain, Showstopper. The Shadow Fiend is going to be played by Restart. We've got Monster playing the Earthshaker, going for potentially some of those big Moonmender, the Moonshaker plays. We got Dig Dig playing the Disruptor. And we got Zing playing Animage, and I just have to change one of my settings here, guys. No, up. There we go. Ah, that feels good. All right. On our Dire side, we're going to have the Knights playing their Dazzle. It's going to be 1-2-2. Wow, I'm dropping the ball there. Usagi Drop is going to be playing the Ember Spirit. Ryu is going to be playing the Queen of Pain. Sasaki's going to be playing the Night Stalker, and Silent is going to be playing the Darkseer. And we are good to go. Perfect timing for us. Besides that, we take a look at our starting items. Nothing unusual for, well, for anyone, really. How many clarities does Earthshaker have? Two. Yeah, everything's very standard here. We do have a set of sentries on either team. And the one time I have it all squared away, it looks like we're not going to have teams clashing, although maybe. There is a chance that FNMDX will run into some heroes here as they move into the jungle. Showstopper is going to lead the way. There is going to be an Ember here, but he will be able to scout them out and back away. And we won't actually see First Blood just yet. We have the wards up on the Disruptor, so he's going to go and place one. And now he's going to turn around to block the pull camp, but they're just going to do it with a Sentry Ward. Is now the Dazzle. He's going to try to run away from his team here, run back to his team, make sure he doesn't get picked off. And they're going to block up that camp, so making sure that stacking isn't available. Because that's the standard camp that the mid heroes will stack up. Queen of Pain's going to get the bottom one, Shadow Fiend's going to get the top bounty rune, so it's all even. And the Disruptor just places Observer Ward here. They spotted out, they know, because they've already gotten an Observer Ward of their own. So that should get dewarded in just a second here. Like I said, both teams starting with Sentry Wards, so Dazzle has his set already. And interesting that they blocked this camp up as well. What they may actually not be blocking all that up because they want they want a stack and they want the Queen of Pain certainly to have stacks, or the Darkseer, if they're able to hard zone out the Darkseer for him to be able to run and take some of those stacks and get some of his farm going. But Darkseer almost hitting level 2 already. He got almost a free wave there. Meanwhile, in the top lane, Showstopper's already used his cogs, getting harassed back a little bit. He'll be okay. Sasaki's gonna run in, hit him with the Void. Silent will back to get a double Ion Shell in his next creep wave, most likely. Want more action on the top. Showstopper taking more damage. It's kind of expected in this initial stage on the Clockwork. This is the time where it's difficult to kind of go out there and get your XP. You got to be a little bit farther out. Now he'll probably step back and do the cogs block and bring the creep wave back to him, back towards his tower. So far in the mid lane, we've got the Queen of Pain leading in CS, but that's to be expected up against the Shadow Fiend. He just needs to get a couple kills to get the ball rolling. See drawing on the map, Darkseer indicating that this rotation's coming from the supports. No. So the Queen of Pain needs to be a little bit safe, a little bit cautious. Showstopper trying to get the top rune, but the Night Stalker's there first. He grabs it. That's a little bit of XP for the Night Stalker. That'll actually hit him up with 2, which won't really increase his strength at this point. He's actually going to hold his point. That's actually quite good. Normally you'd get Hunter in the Night at this point, but it's not night yet, so if he determines that he really does need the Crippling Fear, he can pick that up if needed, but most likely that point will go into Hunter in the Night. Now if he was on the other side going up against a Queen of Pain, Darkseer, heroes like that, you might expect him to put the point into Silence, but there we go. He has picked up Hunter in the Night. He especially needs that to, once the first night happens at 4 minutes, he needs to be stronger. be the Night Stalker, be the hero that everyone's scared of at night. And without Hunter in the Night, you're nothing special. All you have is just a really long silence at that point. And with only 1 point in it, it's not that much longer. It goes from 3 to 5. They're constantly going and checking these camps in the jungle, trying to find places that they can stack. Silent up to 3 now. This is where he starts getting those points, the levels up in the ion shell, and it becomes too difficult for Am to really deal with. But Am already electing to get the Ring of Regen, and he's probably going to go with the Ring of Health next. He may actually choose to complete his headdress, and Showstopper so close to getting this rune. It's just lying there on top of the cogs, but it will be the Queen of Pain who's going to bottle it up, and now Showstopper's in trouble. Here's that first 4 minutes, the first night, as Night Stalker starts running around real quickly. Speaking of running around quickly, Monster comes Radiant's flying in with a haste rune, but everyone will have backed away, and we still won't have our first blood just yet. And Sasaki's actually going to go all the way back to base, get his HP up, before he tries any further aggression. We still haven't seen a play on mid from either team. Nice fissure from way back onto the Queen of Pain. Could be a lot of damage on her if she eats two raises. And the Night Stalker wrapping around, coming in behind the Shadow Fiend, could be devastating as well. We might see that as they hit 6, and the Queen of Pain just hit 6 right now. You know, on the top lane, we're going to have action as Ember's going to be diving for Showstopper here. This could very well be our first blood, indeed it will, as first blood goes the way of Knight, dropping that offlane clockwork, and no, he almost died. Never mind, he bottles it up. I think the courier just delivered that bottle too.
Radiant's top tower is
Man, that was
attack.
Close. Meanwhile, there was action in the mid lane. Sasaki came running and got glimpsed back, but he will get away with about 200 HP. He actually turns around to get a void off, which probably cost him a little bit more. Still just that one first blood so far.
Denied.
All these rotations. This is what, when you've got a strong roaming support like the Dire Sight do with the Night Stalker, it helps basically draw the supports away from the bottom lane, which creates space for the Darkseer. Because the supports on the Radiant side need to be cautious of securing the farm for their Shadow Fiend and keeping him safe, because they know, especially once he hit the first knight at 4 minutes, that there's going to be pressure applied to him. The Night Stalker is going to be on him, and look at this. As soon as a hero shows up in the mid lane, there's the Night Stalker wrapping around. Come on with the Queen of Pain. That's a dead hero. And we just see Dig Dig on the Disruptor going down there. Queen of Pain not even having to use her ult there. And now Restart, well, now he's got to just kind of fall back to his stacks, which he's only got one stack here, but he's got to be doing the jungle and trying to stay away from that middle lane because it's so scary for him. But he sees the Night Stalker backing. He sees the Night Stalker at about half HP, so he knows he's probably got a little bit of space here. But he does still need to be careful of that Sonic Wave that can come out from the Queen of Pain. I think they're just going to need a little bit more damage coming from another source if Queen of Pain wants to kill the Shadow Fiend, but still something to be wary of. And meanwhile, on the bottom lane, Silent's been fissured off. Gonna try and juke and jive. He's got no mana. He does have a mango, though, and Soul Ring up in 2 seconds, so he could pop that and surge away if needed. In fact, he will pop his Soul Ring and get an Ion Shell up on that Night Stalker, who will look to go for a kill here. Did Night Stalker pick up Silence yet? Nope. Still level 2. At level 3, he'll probably pick up another point in Void anyways. This is that one situation where, if this Night Stalker was 4 at this point, that Animage would definitely have to be scared.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
That monster going to be doing stacking the camp, and oh, Sasaki will actually just not see him, but now he sees him. And just pinging out the fact that there's going to be stacking. Where he's standing right now actually blocks that camp from
not
spawning.
So
he was making sure that that wasn't going to be a possibility, but unfortunately it will cost him his life, as Restart had just rotated to the bottom rune to pick that up.
Radiant's middle tower is under
and
attack.
He goes down as a result. While on the top lane, Showstopper had to go back and get HP and mana. Now he's heading back up there again. Still not level 6, but he's getting quite close. And he is still ahead of Silent in terms of XP. But Silent's actually fallen back into the jungle now to get a little bit more XP and farm. And that's created some space for the Night Stalker. So as soon as that first night is finished, slide the Night Stalker into the bottom lane, have him soak up XP down there. Darkseer goes into the jungle where he's going to be able to get more gold. And just a nice rotation there coming out from Knights, making full use of their lanes and who's able to farm what at what stage in the game. We will see Showstopper go down once again in the top lane, as that is his second death so far and still didn't hit 6.
Radiant's top tower,
but he is getting close.
Radiant structures are fortified.
And it looks like they may actually be able to bring this tower down. Glyph has already been used. They'll probably have to wait for the next creep wave, but it doesn't look like there's any kind of response coming out from the Radiant side. Monster might make his way up there, but Showstopper just TP's on in. Here comes that move for that top tier 1 tower now. This will get Showstopper at 6 as he hits that right now, but they're just going to die for him once again. And Monster is coming in. Dig's up here as well. This could not be a good decision for them. They're going to TP in both their cores as well, as the Shadow Fiend and the Animage come TPing on in. They get the kill on the Dazzle, but the Ember is able to jump away. And maybe a little bit of a wasted TP there coming out from the Animage, but they will keep that top tower alive, but really the Animage didn't do anything in the end. I think they expected it to be a bigger fight than it was. So Zing will waste a little bit of time making his way back down to the bottom lane, and now we're going to have a dive on the top, but Monster drops the Echo Slam followed by the Fissure, and they're going to man up on the Ember Spirit. It will be a trade, the Earthshaker for the Ember, but definitely in a favorable trade for FNMDX. There's our game now, 3-4. And that top tier 1 tower still stays alive. Night Stalker now level 5. He has picked up that point in Crippling Fear. He had to hit 6, so he will be able to pick up Darkness and use that to make it nighttime anytime he chooses. Or Super Night if it's nighttime. And there we go, first hook shot of the game, as it will find its target right onto that Night Stalker. And who will get the kill? It is going to be Zing on the Animage, so more gold in that Animage's pocket. We did have the Ember come down here as well, and now we're going to have a TP come in from Monster. Of course, Echo Slam still on cooldown from that play at the top. His Ember actually doesn't have a Remnant down. He's got one more charge left available to him, but he actually doesn't have it available right now. And oh, Zing getting quite low, actually using the Mana Void there. And trying to see what play the Ember Spirit's going to go for. He's actually not going to do anything with his Remnants. He's just going to man up. We had Queen of Pain coming back down. And now he's going to run right into Restart, into the jungle. And Ryu is in so much trouble, down at 37 HP. Last raise will land. And that's going to drop the Shadow Fiend now. Nighttime has hit. Sasaki is going to chase down that Shadow Fiend, get revenge for his fallen teammate. Requiem was about to come out, but Crippling Fear is there to cancel that. Monster now will look to try and help out his teammate, but he doesn't have enough mana to use his Fissure. And Shadow Fiend will go down, kill going to the Night Stalker. As we're all even now, 5 kills apiece. Advantage there. Even though it's a 1-for-1, advantage goes the way of the Dire. Top tier 1 will get denied by Zing on the Animage. He's looking pretty good so far. He's got his Perseverance, he's got his Treads. He even picked up a Ring of Regen, upgraded to a Poor Man's Shield. You know, he's got a lot of gold. He's got a lot of gold so far for an Animage. We're about 13 minutes in, getting close to that Battle Fury timing. But obviously he's going to be a little bit further behind with regards to like the standard 13-14. Minute Battle Fury, because he's chosen to upgrade his Treads, pick up the Ring of Regen, all that, because he was up against a Darkseer. Speaking of which, let's actually bring up, we'll switch to our net worth first of all, so we can see where it all stands, where we stand in this game. 6k just broken by the Shadow Fiend. He's leading the way, almost a full 1,000 ahead of the Ember Spirit, who's just about 300-400 ahead of the Animage. And Queen of Pain, quite a bit below. That's quite surprising. 2,000 gold behind the Shadow Fiend, but Shadow Fiend has close to double the CS, and he's going to go on the Queen of Pain right here, but everyone's there backing up the Queen of Pain. The hookshot will come in from the Clockwork, but it's just going to lead him to his death as both the Shadow Fiend and the Clockwork go down. Kills going both to Ember Spirit, and after that kill, they did use Wall, although I don't think that was really necessary, but either way, they will probably be able to push down this Tier 1 tower. I don't see any way that FNMDX is going to be able to defend here. They will have a Fissure and possibly an Echo.
Radiant structures are fortified.
But that isn't really going to help them out. Dropping an Observer Ward to give them a little bit more vision to safely form up in the safe lane. I'm not the biggest fan of that ward, but I am a big fan of this ward, though. It's a very deep ward coming up from the Dire early on into the game, and it tracks the movement coming out from that mid lane. And when you consider how it works with this ward, you pretty much have any action coming out from the Radiant side, you know where they're going. Those wards working very well together. And look at that. Monster. Actually, it was Dig, excuse me. Immediately recognizing the fact that that was going to get warded up there and countering it. We'll open up, see where we stand with items. We've got Chainmail already picked up by Clockwork. Choosing to go for the what is now pretty much standard Tranquil build on the Clockwork. So he's going to be going for Blade Mail as his next item. Shadow Fiend has picked up his mech. Attack. And we'll compare Dire's that with the mech fortified on the Darkseer on the other side. So both teams having their mech, and we might have a little bit of action Radiant's here as we still stand attack around waiting for a potential push here on this Tier 1. But we'll go back to the items here as Animage getting closer and closer to finishing that Battle Fury, about 1200 away from completing that. Well, Static Field will go down to help them escape. They're even going to use the cogs as well. And they'll all safely get back to their side of the map.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Monster's gone with Tranquils. He's also picked up a Sage's Mask, so probably going to be Soul Ring for the Urshaker. Dig has gone with his Arcanes. And then we move on to the Dire side. Nothing too surprising coming up from the Dazzle. Just has his Arcanes and a Bracer. Besides that, Queen of Pain got her Treads going for her Aghanims. About halfway through completing that. Ember Spirit's got his Travels, and he's going to be going for his Battle Fury as his next item. We already mentioned Silent having his mech complete, but he's got his Arcanes and his Soul Ring as well. Fortified. And last but not least, the Night Stalker, who has gone for a pretty much standard Radiant's build on the Night Stalker, going fallen. Boots, Urn, Stick. They're actually going to pop Darkness here. Attack. And that means they could go for a play here on the mid, or maybe just wants to scare them off, but it looks like his team has kind of TP'd on in. And rightfully so, FNMDX will back away. Respect the fact that there was going to be some heroes coming. And look at this, Ember's going to find the Shadow Fiend. There's a lot of Radiant heroes nearby, but here come all the Dire, as we're going to have Static Storm going down Shallow Grave getting used to keep that Ember Spirit alive for as long as he can. He'll actually be okay with a heal from the Dazzle. Restart in the middle of everything. There's nothing to keep him alive. He'll go down. Requiem will fly when he goes down. Now the Ember will look for another kill. He wants maybe to dive on this Clockwork. He wants to kill any of these heroes, actually, but they're all quite low and quite killable for him. But with the three of them combined, not really choosing to risk it. They're just going to go for the safe push on the Tier 2. He will TP up to the top lane to stop Zing from pressuring that Tier 1. That leaves his three heroes here in the mid lane. There is a Remnant in the mid lane, so he can jump right back to it.
Dire's top tower
is they're going to drop
attack
this mid-tier tier 2 tower
Radiant's
down to about half
tower
HP.
Is under attack.
Fissure will come out, stunning the Night Stalker. Showstopper is going to come in from the side. His hookshot is on cooldown. Will he be able to get a Cogs buck? He's not even going to need it, as the Glimpse is going to bring the Night Stalker back, but oh, he almost runs up onto the high ground, but he runs right into the Animage, who will get in front, start body blocking him, as Clockwork's now able to get in range, the Battery Assault stunning him up. Meanwhile, we've got another fight, as the Shadow Fiend is going to go down. The Queen of Pain came in, and I believe she killed him with the Sonic Wave. No, that's still a cooldown. What am I talking about? Nice heal coming out from the Dazzle, as they're just kind of man-fighting the Clockwork there, but Queen of Pain getting the kill onto the Earthshaker. now. Will they keep going here? This is crazy. We already lost three heroes on the side of FNMDX. Somehow, Knights haven't lost a single hero. This Dazzle, 1-2-2, doing work. Keeping everyone alive, and he's used up every ounce of his mana. Still needs his arcanes to come up before he's going to be able to do anything further. But that has allowed them to stick around long enough for them to find three kills and then get the tier 2 tower on the back of it. And that's quite a lead so far for Knights, as they've already passed 5,000 gold lead. It's already 6,000 actually gold lead in their favor. XP's also passed the 5,000 mark. So far, things looking great for the Knights, as Darkness will get popped once again from the Night Stalker, as he's already halfway through his Aghanim Scepter. And take a quick look back at her Queen of Pain, who's picked up the Staff of Wizardry, and now she's about 500 away from completing hers. So the items are starting to come out here for the heroes on the Dire side. That last team fight win is going to be huge for them. Rekindled. But we've got some important pickups. Still quite a bit of ways, actually. We don't have the Blade Mail just yet for Showstopper, although he's sitting about 350 gold, so he's close to completing that one. Shadow Fiend has his Ogre Club, but still a long way away from completing that BKB and Monster, sitting at 150 gold. That is, well, it's not a Blink Dagger is what it is. 2100 gold away from that one. Battle Fury completed on the Animage, 20 minutes. That is not the timing he was looking for. He's looking like his farm was doing alright, maybe just a tad Dire's bit slow. Middle tower is under attack. But it looks like he's falling further and further behind. Oh no, Monster with the Fissure wanted to trap and stun up the Night Stalker, but instead he's trapped up his own Shadow Fiend, and Restart will go down. He does let two Requiems fly. And now they've already dropped the wall. Showstopper will retreat back through his own kinetic field, and Monster unfortunately will get stuck by the Searing Change. And Yusagi drop's not done. He jumps forward, he gets the kill onto the clockwork, and he wants a triple here. He's already got a double. Dig is in trouble. He will get the glimpse off, but not before he's slashed down by the Ember Spirit. Triple kill for Yusagi drop on that Ember. And they don't have creep wave support just yet, so it's going to be a little difficult for them to pressure that tier 2. But they will have time to... Actually, they might not have time to really wait for it. So they may just choose to back and farm up some stuff in the jungle. But as I say that, they are looking like they are just going to pressure the bottom tier 2 here. They're going to use the Weave, so they're going to have tons of armor by the time any heroes on the Radiant side get down here.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Blade Mail just picked up by the clockwork there. And there's that Aghanim Scepter for the Queen of Pain as well. And I don't see them engaging here. So the tier 2 tower will go down. So a right call, good call there coming out from Knights, recognizing the fact that they could, in fact, bring down that tier 2 tower. Hesitation by me. That's why I'm casting their plane. Well, the question stands, how is Zing going to be able to find the space to farm? His team's kind of crumbling all around him right now, as he's trying to find the farm on this map, and it's going to be a little ways before this Animage is going to be able to farm and stand toe-to-toe with some of these heroes on Knights. The BKB on the Shadow Fiend is very, very important for them. If they can get that, then he's going to be a lot stronger in the team fight. Of course, the last team fight went a little poorly when the Fissure came across here, trapped the Shadow Fiend right there, and... Yeah, I mean, BKB would have helped keep him alive for a little bit, but so obviously the Fissure was a little misplaced there. It was really, really close Radiant's to not trapping him. The Fissure ended, like, right here, but Shadow Fiend just couldn't fit through there. Too fat. But outside of being Fissure blocked by your own teammate, BKB being able to pop that is going to keep him alive for quite a while. And right now, the Night Stalker silence is actually really big against the Shadow Fiend.
Dire's structures are fortified.
Because obviously he then can't raise, which is a big source of his damage early on. He can stop him from Requiem, which is huge in preventing damage, but also dealing damage as well. And even more so, he's got a 50% miss chance at nighttime. So the Night Stalker silence is absolutely gigantic against Shadow Fiend early on in the game. So that BKB is going to help him just kind of clear that and also protect him from a lot of the damage that's coming out from the dire side.
Dark light.
Looks like Knights will go for a Rosh here. Night Stalker just finishing his Aghanims. Do we have anyone coming in from the Radiant side? They did just flare in, so they know what's going on. Nighttime just ended, but there's the darkness getting cast.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
There's an Invis still sitting there at bottom room. Rosh getting quite low. 2,500 HP left on the big man.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
As FNMDX still looking for potential opening to go in here. It looks like they'll just back away. You see Rosh going down. Clockwork wants to jump on in. Look at Night Stalker. Great play there. So the Night Stalker has his Aghanim, and he's just seeing where the Clockwork is, and he's just blocking it. Oh, huge Echo Slam coming out. This could be it. FNMDX actually had a great opening here. They're going to drop two heroes already. Usagi drop getting quite low as well, but he will be able to bring down Restart on that Shadow Fiend, but Aegis will bring him back. It won't bring back the Shadow Fiend. Scream of Pain coming out. Or Sonic Wave, not the Scream of Pain. What am I talking about? Coming out from the Queen of Pain. That'll finish off the Disruptor. Now Showstopper. He's quite low, ticking out from that dot from the Queen of Pain. The right clicks from the Queen of Pain will finish him off. Now Zing just going for the Tier 1 tower. He will get it. He won't get the last hit. His creeps will, but he will be able to bring it down. So he's accomplishing something while his team was looking like that was a pretty good fight for them. They, show fight recap. Please come back. I wish there was a button I could hit to show the last fight recap, but fortunately that isn't a feature in the Dodo 2s. Monster, oh, he's juking and jiving, but he's just not going to find a way out of here. He could TP out. Oh, I actually thought the Searing Change was already used. My mistake, he couldn't TP out. Monster going for the proper play, and Zing gets caught up here in the top lane. Oh no. I was so concerned about Monster as he was trying to juke and jive, trying to get away from that Ember Spirit. He was sitting at 1,800 gold, and he lost a good chunk of that, but there was a lot of gold in that bottom fight. But I want to go back to the Clockwork throwing the flare in, so they had vision inside Rosh Pit. They could see everything that was going on in here. And Clockwork was sitting here, and he just wanted to hookshot in and potentially steal the Aegis. But the Night Stalker, sitting here with the Aghanims, could see up onto the high ground. He could see the Clockwork down there, and he was just sliding back and forth, making sure that the Clockwork didn't have a hook target. So when he tried to hook in, he ended up hitting the Night Stalker and wasn't able to jump on in and steal the Aegis. Good play there coming up from Sasaki. As now he's in a little bit of trouble as he's going to get hit with a Shallow Grave. That's going to keep him alive for a bit. That's actually going to keep him alive long enough to drop the Clockwork, and he'll actually get back to the safety of his own team and not die altogether. As Knights find another kill, as they continue to distance themselves from FNMDX, or back-to-back reigning champions of SCS the last 2 weeks. As they're up against the wall, 9-21 is our kill total.
Radiant structures
and now they start breaking the Tier 3. Get up on the high ground. Tier 3 is down to about 500 HP. It is going to probably fall in this push. We'll have their Clockwork back up in 2 seconds, but no hookshot available for another 12 Radiant's following his respawn. Has fallen. As the Tier 3 goes down. Well, she gets a fissure off, but Static Field unfortunately won't trap anyone. Showstopper goes forward, drops the cogs, and the wall gets dropped on his head, and then he's just kind of trapped, and then Sonic Wave comes out from the Queen of Pain to finish him off. So Showstopper, who just respawned, will go down once again. This is looking like it is going to be Arax going down, as slow as the push may be. BKB pop by Restart, lets the Requiem go. Maybe this has delayed them long enough. We're going to have a vacuum sucking them all back in. Not actually onto the wall. Have they done enough to hold here? Doesn't look like it. There's a re-engage coming here from Knights as they'll pick off the Disruptor. And now they'll come back in for that melee barracks, sitting now at 200 HP. just restart. The only one left defending here. Everyone else went back to Fountain. And they will get him. It will cost them their Night Stalker, but they also get the Animage with that Sonic Wave. It caught him in the back. Oh, Monster! There we go, with the BKB, or with the Blink Dagger, excuse me. Lands the Fissure, jumps on in, but so many heroes were low, but he just couldn't finish them off. Oh, that's really unfortunate. If he had Echo Slam there, that probably would have been a triple kill for him. But he at least forces them out of the base, at least keeps the Range Racks alive. Which, I mean, it's not ideal. It's definitely not ideal, but it means that at least the range aren't going to be super strong for the Dire side. Which it does help defending against them. And also, one thing that people always forget is that when there's a super creep, the super creeps give less XP and gold than standard creeps in the lane. And this range creep not being a super creep, you know, it's only one creep in the wave, but still, gold and XP is gold and XP. That's what we're all fighting for in the end. Like, kills are nice and all, but it's gold and XP. And whichever team gets more of that and is able to win the team fights is eventually able to win the game. Of course, there can be comeback victories where a team is way behind in gold and still winning team fights, but generally, the team with the lead has a lead for a reason. Well, we had a couple pickups here. Clockwork picking up his four staff. We're going to have a Scotty picked up by the Ember Spirit. We had Darkseer pick up a Blink Dagger. He's also finished his Guardian Greaves. And Queen of Pain picked up her BKB. A lot of big pickups there coming out from, from both teams, really. We also have a gem up on the Night Stalker. Glimmer Cape finished on the Dazzle. Anything else surprising? Not really. We've got a Yasha completed by the Animage. Everything else pretty standard. Looks like Dire's all backing to smoke here, and they will pop it. And that was a ping. Was that a ping from the Queen of Pain or from Earthshaker? It was yellowy. I saw the very end of it. I think it was from the Queen of Pain. So I don't think Dire knows. They certainly had no way of seeing unless a flare flew over them, but I don't think it did. Oh, they're all standing here in behind the Shadow Fiend, and now they'll choose to engage. Oh, great Wall Vacuum, but better Static Storm Kinetic Field. Restart, pops the BKB, Requiem goes. As we lose our Darkseer, traded for the Disruptor. And now, Showstopper on the run, he's going to go down. Restart left to stand there in man fight. Zing TP's on in to try to help him out, but Ryu blinks on in, finishes off that Shadow Fiend as we look like we're going to have another teamfight win here for Knights. So they will finally get that range racks. But will they be able to take down another lane? They've got another 50 seconds before the Shadow Fiend's going to be back up. They're going to ping to go to top and start chipping away at that tier 3. Just the Earthshaker and Animage left to defend. We do have still Echo Slam on cooldown here for the Earthshaker. He used it in that first engage. Certainly Zing isn't going to be beefy enough to be able to jump on in and do too much here. Tier 3 will go down. Darkness has been popped as well, so they have even less vision. And they're just getting forced back here. Despite the fact that they now have four heroes up, they just can't defend here. Well, Dire will back away. They actually take the range racks and not the melee racks. It is much easier to bring down. It's got less armor. And certainly if they got forced back, the range rack doesn't regen. Hookshot getting used by the Clockwork onto the Dazzle, make sure he's not able to retreat, but Dig also used the Glimpse at the same time, but it's not going to matter. They still get the kill on the Dazzle. Unfortunately, the rest of the Dire side has come back in to save their Dazzle, and that means a dead Animage, and maybe dead Disruptor. No, TP will finish. Monster's going to try to do the same, but he's caught with a Void, and he will go down as Knights. 30-12 now. A lane and a half of racks ahead, and they're going to look to come back and get this melee racks in the top lane. Soggy drop? Maybe? Nope. We'll jump back. Yeah, it's just the two of them here. There's not enough There's not enough heroes here on the Dire side to help them out to make sure that they're able to bring down that rack safely. So they'll back, they'll get their HP and mana as you see everyone kind of hanging out by the fountain. It was just the darks here pressuring the bottom lane. But a very commanding lead for Knights as they're almost 25,000 gold ahead of FNMDX, and XP's past the 20k mark as well. And this is going to be a very, very tough position for FNMDX to try to come back from. I know I keep saying it, but FNMDX has won the last two SCS Semi-Pro Cup Series tournaments that have held the last two Sundays. And here they are up against the ropes in the quarterfinals against Knight. Well, here they go. Gonna potentially try to push up here onto the high ground. A little surprised that they don't just go top and go for that easy Rax, securing the two lanes of Rax down, but guess I'm sensing that they've got an advantage here. Darkness is going to end. No, it's not. Never mind. Well, let's start chipping away at the tier 3 here. Smoke it, purchased by the Earthshaker. He knows he needs to have a big Echo Slam here, and now, yeah, Darkness has finished. They don't have another Darkness back up, so they're going to be fighting here at night, daytime. Static Storm, Sonic Wave actually only hits one. It's just the Clockwork who will go down, doesn't have buyback. Restart, BKB, Requiem. Now they're just going to jump in, try to finish off Silent. They will find it. Now Restart, kind of a little bit, maybe too far out. Never mind, his team's there to keep him alive. And looks like FNMDX has held here. But Knights, they're not done. They're going to re-engage here. They're going to come back on in. As Monster getting quite low on that Earthshaker, but looks like he'll be okay. As they all drop back to the fountain and get their HP and mana back up, but in the meantime, the tier 3 has gone down. Now the melee rack's getting focused as well. It's about to go down. As the three heroes just kind of come in. Oh my goodness. They're all gone. Where did they go? Where did they go? The Sleight of Fist from the Ember Spirit gets them down to about two-thirds. And then the Queen of Pain just comes in. Ryu just completely demolishes them, blows them all up. And those three heroes, just gone, deleted from the map. They go down, Clockwork comes on in, tries to do something, but he goes down. GG, well played, will come out as Knights run all over FNMDX for our first game of the night.
Dire victory.
Wow, GG. That was some pretty good Dota to start off the night. I like it. Knights, they had a pretty damn good game there. Pretty damn good game. They made some good rotations, all around good play, actually. Good rotations early game, recognizing the fact that they've got a Night Stalker and a Darkseer. As soon as that first night finishes, rotating the two. Night Stalker sitting in the bottom lane, getting his XP. Darkseer then hops into the jungle, is able to farm up a few stacks that they were able to get, but most of them blocked off by the wards placed by FNMDX early on in the game. But still, coming out of that laning phase, they just kind of kept the ball rolling. They got the ganks going. We had that great fight at Roche where Sasaki on the Night Stalker had just finished his Aghanims, and he was making sure to block the Clockwork from jumping on in with the hookshot, and he did just that. Even though that fight actually went pretty well for FNMDX, I think they lost three heroes and managed to kill two heroes of Knights, but they also burned through the Aegis. So in the end, it was kind of a 3-for-3 trade. That was a pretty good fight for FNMDX, but still going forward, just Knights didn't stop. Pressure, and just bringing down those heroes. It was just a good game so far. Good game by Knights, and a good start to the night. But that's going to wrap it up for this game. We will have our second game up in just a second, as it's the Lobster, what was her name again? The Lobster Fisherman will be playing Knights in the semifinals, and I'm going to hop into that lobby. Hopefully you guys won't go anywhere, but I'm Niz, thanks for watching, and we'll be back in just a minute.